show the world your amazing endless love. Bring down your fire. Bring
everyone to the service this morning. The other Sunday or so, somebody, I think it was Brunel or somebody, I'm not sure who it was, told everybody to stand up and shake each other's hands. And would you do that again this morning? Stand to your feet, say hi to your neighbor, and yeah. Some of them are from the distance, some of them haven't been here in a while. The Florida snowbirds are back, at least some of them. All righty. Thank you so much. It's good to familiarize yourself with your neighbor and know who is beside you and so forth, not only on Sunday mornings, but always. So, by way of announcements, I do have some announcements here. March, of course, is the month for Sunday school during preaching, so the children will be dismissed before the preaching starts then, as well as the offering. And also some changes in schedule here. I kind of think, in a way, for some reason I've been kind of thinking this, and I don't know, it seems so far that I don't know, was it the Lord or do I just happen to be right on it, but it's the year of cancellations. And I don't know what to make out of it completely, but we've had numerous cancellations, but we do have a change for the fall conference. The fall conference is scheduled for November 7th through 10th. Remember that. Put that in your notes. So it'll be in November, not in October, like we always do. And if we like that, it'll probably revert to always going that route rather than in October. I think about every October we've had it, I've always heard people say that it'd be so nice to just have it a little bit later because it's such a busy time. So that's our reason for changing it. That, and it's a very high tourist area in this area and community, and the hotels are full, and it's always been a bit of a challenge. So, also the Oasis Business Seminar had been scheduled for Saturday, June 22nd, 2024. That date is changed to Friday, June 21st. So that date has changed, June 21st. Put that down. Also an announcement here. I want to listen to this one for sure. There's new cameras in all public spaces. So wherever there's public spaces, they put on cameras. And I mean, do they have a bunch of cameras? And you're very well secured and watched. And even the bathrooms don't have cameras. No, they don't, but they can see you go in and out. So, but there's cameras everywhere, and it's simply for the safety, and especially with all that's happening in our world today, where there's people coming across the borders with intentions that I could just never imagine that we see a day like we have today. And the devil is certainly in the picture here, and he is making the United States very vulnerable. And we know what happened in Russia just last week. So I think security is a very important thing that we have here, and we respect them. There, a lot of them, they're sitting in different places and just making sure that there is total protection here so that people won't, intruders won't come in unknown and so forth. So we ask God's blessing upon them and all the different places and all the different things that are going on back in the sound room. And there's just people everywhere. It was one Sunday morning, I went around and counted all the people that were volunteering. And this includes the baby room. We thank them as well, back in the nursery. There was 50-some people volunteering on a Sunday morning. And you think of that. And yeah, you bring those 50 people in here, we're full. So they're out to watch you and so forth. So God bless them. Amen. Brother John will be bringing the message today. There is people from that are scattered around the globe. We welcome the snowbirds back. The dark tan people that are here today from the sun. Thank you for coming back. We missed you all. And then there's people over in Israel and in Jordan. So we pray that your safety would be secured in the Lord, and that his name would be glorified in whatever and wherever they go. Amen. And then there's other people. So it's a blessing to know that a small building like this, well, to some people would be a large building, but to a small building like this, so many people spread across the globe and the world. It's very interesting that we have footsteps in a lot of places. Let's just bow our heads at this time and pray. Father, we thank you this morning for the blessings of life, truth, and heaven. Father, we thank you. This is our time. This is our moment. This is where you've placed our shoes and our feet to walk on this globe. And we walk here with a purpose. And there's times we go through that we almost don't know our purpose. There's times we go through that we see clearly. And we know that you receive the most glory through our lives if we walk in faith. This is what you have said in your Bible. And I thank you, Father, for this. And I pray that you would help us all. Be with us this morning in the service and help us to come out of our old ways, our old ideas, our old shyness, and to worship you with clarity and surety, that our hands would be raised to you, our hearts would be before you, Lord, and that we would come with open face. Thank you, Father. Part of the reason we're together here today is a time of worship to you. This is something we don't necessarily do wherever we walk, but we do it in church. And this is the time we take that liberty. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for everyone that is here. We pray that you would open every heart, open our minds, and so that you can teach us and lead us into the way of truth. We bless you, Father. We ask that you would be with every facet of the, from Sunday school teachers, the preachers, to all the different, the singers, to all the different ones that are holding responsibilities in different places. Bless them as well, and as well as we're in here. We thank you and bless you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Praise God. All right, the family of the week is Ellis and Twyla. If you would come up here. Can Twyla get up here? She is, we'll try it. Twyla has had a hip replacement on the one side and has made a big difference. Now the other one is in pain. And isn't that the way life works? Probably pain there all along, but now you feel that. And it's amazing that you're going to walk up here with a piece of, what, plastic or titanium or something? Titanium? Okay, yeah. Amen. Wow. Well, blessed be the name of the Lord. I was looking at these notes. They get sent out to us, and so we see them as we go down through the family of the week. Ellis and Twyla Miller. So the questions are, where were you both born and raised? Ellis was born in Millersburg, Ohio, and raised close to Berlin, Ohio, close to where you live. Twyla was born in Worcester, Ohio, and raised in Holmesville, Ohio. Where do you presently reside? And that would be in Berlin, Ohio, a mile west. How long have you been married? 33 years. Yeah, that's wonderful. Introduce us to your children. How many? Names and ages. We have one child. His name is Brandon. He is 30 years old and lives in Montana. What are your occupations? Twyla is a homemaker, a bread baker, a good cook. That's not on here, but it's, I know that. Yeah. Ellis is office/sales manager at Mount Hope Fence. What is your family motto? Live each day as if it was your last. What is your favorite scripture verse for each of you? Ellis, the entirety of Psalms 91. Yes, and that would take a little bit to read it, so we'll leave it at that. Twyla is Isaiah 43:2. When you pass through waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers, they shall not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, nor shall the flames scorch you. Next part of it is, what brought you to Oasis? Ellis, I was looking for something more of God than what I was getting from the culture where I came from. And this was as a youth. I remember, you go way back. Twyla, I was at Crossroads pretty much since it started and continued when we became Oasis Tabernacle. You were part of us from what age? What, about 16, 17? 17 years old. You have always been, pretty much always been with us. And you've been very strong supporters, both of you. I honor you tremendously for that. What do you appreciate most about Oasis Tabernacle? The teaching, the people, and the worship. Describe one thing you really like or appreciate about your spouse. Ellis says, Twyla has always made our home a place of refuge for me. And Twyla, I appreciate how well Ellis takes care of me, especially in the last year. He has done way over and above and beyond. Amen. Because of the issues with her hips. Twyla, you'll be going in for a replacement of the other hip when? May 1st. Ellis, what is your favorite thing, hobby, activity in life? Listen to this one. He collects cast iron. Have you ever seen a truck go down the road that's all laid, you know, you got all kinds of iron sticking out everywhere? That's not what he's talking about. He takes cast iron pans. It's kind of something. It is. Has a way of processing the whole thing that he makes it just like new, an old pan, and he kind of collects them, and it's kind of an amazing thing. Is it, Twyla? Oh, okay, okay. I've been in some discussions a little bit there. and traveling and camping. Twyla's favorite things is traveling and camping. Okay. Number 12, what person has marked your life in the most positive way? Twyla says, my husband, he has taught me so much. And you know, I thought about this, John. We need to make a change in our question. All the women should say their husbands, and they all do. We should ask, beside your husband, who? Because they all say that. Besides your husband, who else? Yeah. Okay. Ellis, and I am honored that you say Wayne Weaver. And it started all the way back when I was in school and he was a substitute teacher. You remember that, don't you? I do too. I would have liked to be a school teacher in my life. I love that. I love little children and teaching them, and we had a lot of fun. Every time that I took the substitute role in the school there, I was drawn very much to the children, and they all liked me. They did, yeah. Amen. I was not one of those staunch teachers, you know. Yeah. Thank you so much. But also, I would like to honor you in a special way that you've been both so supportive all these years. Very strong. You stood strong, never wavered. And I just bless you tremendously. You are certainly foundational to this church. Number 13, share a short testimony of God's work and leading of your life. Ellis, currently the Lord is speaking to me about fearing the future with all that is happening in the world right now. He is saying, only fear me and trust in me. Your future is taken care of. Amen. Twyla, the last year has been a year of severe pain and trials, but the Lord keeps reminding me that all this is for something. I don't know what all that something is, but I choose to trust in Him to perfect me what He has started. To perfect in me what He has started. Amen. We don't know what all that pain is about, but we also know that as we get older, we start wearing down and wearing out. Somehow, I'm not quite sure I'm there, but I sense some differences. My hair not the same color anymore, and so is life. Thank you so much for your blessing that you've been here. Amen. Amen. God bless you, and we want to pray for them. Father, I pray now for Twyla. I pray that You would help the pain in her hip. We know Paul Spielman is sitting in our midst. He doesn't have any cartilage in his shoulder, and he was in severe pain for a long time. And it was one day You healed him, and he is pain-free. And Lord, if he is pain-free in that because You did it, then Lord, I also pray this prayer upon Twyla, Sister Twyla, that she would be pain-free, that You would assist her. And Lord, that You would show her her purpose also further in what's coming ahead. And also, Brother Ellis, I pray that in the name of Jesus, as he leads out the home, as he walks, whatever he does, Lord, the strength that he has, the solidness that is in him, Lord, he's been a pillar in this church. They both have. He's been a pillar here. And I thank You, and I bless You, Lord, that You've sent Ellis and Twyla into our lives and into this church, Lord, because they've been a tremendous strength. Even in the hardest times and in the most difficult times that I think we as a church has ever gone through and so forth, You have always called this couple to stand, and they have been so faithful in doing that. And we thank You for them. Father, we pray that in a special way You would bless them. And in all the different ministries that they were part of, we pray, Father, that You would bless them and continue to bless them and reward them, even in this world, we pray. And we ask this all in the name of Jesus. Amen. Ellis, you were also, you and Twyla both, but you were a youth leader for how many years? 16 years. Did a very good job. And a lot of youth went through, and you helped them. You helped them a lot. And you were like a father to so many. Thank you so much. And now you're the chief bottle washer in the kitchen, the food prep. He's the one that takes care of that. So thank you so much. God bless you. Amen. Praise God. Let's give them a nice clap. Amen. All right. I think I had a Bible verse that I thought about bringing forth, but I think because of time, there's more important things to do. So I will take my place back here, and we just ask that you would participate in worship. Bless the Lord from your heart. Take the boldness that you need. Amen. Learn to worship Him here. We worship Him wherever we are. Learn to worship Him here. Amen. God bless you all. I'll leave it at that.
You knew it when you Season of Passover, Pesach, in the next weeks, and it's a special time for the Lord. There's a lot of things that happened during Passover. One is the Exodus, the miracle of the Exodus, and also the crucifixion of Jesus and the resurrection. And, you know, as we enter this season, Jesus, before he went over and was crucified, he was praying over Jerusalem. In Matthew 23, you can read that prayer, and there was the woes and the sorrows and the thing against the spiritual leaders and the scribes and people in Jerusalem in that day. And then he ended with this, and that is, blessed is he, I will not return until you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And it was in context, he was speaking about the city of Jerusalem and the leadership. And it's something that we're removed from, so we don't think about, but the temple is something that was in the midst of Israel for thousands of years, whether it was the tabernacle and then Solomon's temple and then finally the second temple. And thousands of years of history, that was the center of the faith in the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And to worship God, you had to go to Jerusalem. You would have to go up three times a year, and unlike today, you know, we come to church polished and clean and sparkling. There, people were dragging their sins with them. The animals and all kinds of things that they needed to sacrifice before the Lord for atonement and various things. And coming into the presence of God, you know, it was physical. You could see where God's presence was. Now, it's hard for us to imagine what that was even like, but it was real. And in that context, Jesus said these words, "You will not see me again until you say, 'Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord,'" because they did not discern the time of their visitation, the time when the Lord would come. Now, thankfully, through their misstep, as Paul says, the door was open for us to believe. But even now, more than ever, as the Bible tells us to do, we need to pray for Jerusalem and pray for the return of his people to accept the Mashiach, accept the Messiah. Lots of trouble, lots of turmoil. You'd say, "Well, God is finished with all that." Well, might as well throw the Bible out then, because it's all speaking about his people. And yes, we're grafted in, but the Lord will come. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
That he feels very clearly with a lot of things that he shared from verse to verse throughout the Bible, that it is Palm Sunday, this day, that he believes Jesus was born. So I thought that's interesting for double value.
Who comes in the name of the Lord. Thank you. Yeah.
Yeshua. seated. I'm going to take up an offering. I'll pray for that. Father, we bless you today for the sacrifice that you've given to us to save us and redeem us, to get us out of this situation that we find ourselves into. Father, we bless you for revealing Yeshua, for revealing Jesus to us. And Lord, we bless you for what you have given. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. May God be praised. We welcome you and we welcome the Spirit of God in this place this morning. I welcome you in the name of Jesus, Yeshua, that we've been singing about. And this is one of those seasons in life that the majority of the church world is preparing for and has been anticipating, known as Easter, and today is Palm Sunday. And it's the day that we remember Jesus riding into Jerusalem on a colt, the foal of a donkey, and people waving palm branches and shouting Hosanna. Amazing times, and when I think about what God has done to secure our salvation, that's what the message is about this morning. Salvation. Look what God has done. And I would like to read a lengthy portion of Scripture today, and we're going to be doing that through the process of the message found in Acts chapter 13. Before I get too far, children. I was thinking about that until I walked right here. Children, you're dismissed for class. You almost thought you were going to get to sit in for the sermon, didn't you? Hey, we love you, children, and have a great Sunday school class this morning.
It was a number of years ago that I started looking through, as I was reading through the book of Acts, and one of the many times coming through the Bible, I was struck with the evangelistic sermons that are preached in the book of Acts. There are a number of them, and I said, man, I need to do a series of messages on great evangelistic sermons in the New Testament. Sermons that had the apostles preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. And they were, I'm sure we're getting them in sort of an abbreviated fashion because they are many times quite short, much shorter than our evangelistic messages and probably much shorter than the one you're getting this morning. But they were very powerful and pointed. And I began to look at the different ways that the gospel was presented, always the same gospel, but to different people with a different emphasis in different ways. And I saw people responding to the gospel message of Jesus Christ, the good news of salvation. And what I found was a common theme in all of those messages is that the message is not focused on the people who are hearing it, but the message is a declaration of look what God has done, and it is a revealing of the Messiah, the one who saves. And there was something incredibly powerful about those messages. Many times the people, the audience, doesn't even show up in the address until at the end where they're called to repentance or called to a decision. But it was a message that says, look what God has done. And that's the theme of the message this morning, because when Paul is given an opportunity to share a word of encouragement, he immediately starts in by saying, look what God has done. Not in so many words, but he actually begins to tell them what God has done. And it's fascinating, and it's encouraging, and it's empowering to see what God Almighty has done, the work that he has done to fulfill the plan of redemption. And when we celebrate Easter and the resurrection, do you realize that in almost every gospel presentation in the book of Acts, the real highlight of the message is when they talk about the resurrection of Jesus from the dead. And the fact is, most times the people would listen until they got to that point. And then it's the resurrection from the dead that some would say, you're nuts, and they would mock. And others would say, we'd like to hear a little bit more about this. And then there were those who believed and received the word gladly. And those were primarily the three responses to the messages that are preached in the book of Acts. Some of those who scoffed got a little bit more feisty as time went on and would hurl some stones or whatever. And I'm going to hope that nobody does that today. Hope you've kept your tomatoes in the cans. Actually, get them out if you're going to throw them. But they got very feisty and they threw stones. They persecuted and they did those types of things. In fact, today we're going to find out that the ministers got expelled from the city, but not before preaching the gospel of look what God has done. So when I think of gospel messages in the New Testament, this is one that is not the first one that's in the book of Acts, but it is one of the first that we really get a picture of on Paul and Barnabas' missionary journeys. When I was looking at these messages, the great evangelistic messages in the New Testament, I was looking at what is the setting? Where is this taking place? Who is the audience? Where is the message actually preached? What is the content of the message? How does the speaker... And you're saying, well, that's boring. Why would we look at that? Well, it's very important because we speak to people on a different level every day. And we're called to share the good news of what God has done. So it's important to see how these preachers approached different groups of people. How did they speak the message to these people? So the setting, the message preached, and then what I always find very fascinating is the response to the message. I mean, Peter had an incredible response to his message in Acts chapter 2 when 3,000 souls are converted. I mean, that is amazing. I mean, I've seen revivals, but that's revival on another level when 3,000 souls in one day are baptized on their confession of faith. I mean, that's quick. No instruction class, no nothing. It's just boom. They were added to the church. That's an incredible response. So when you look at that, you can make every message you preach afterward feel like I'm a failure. What have I done with my life? But that's not the point. Because even in the response, we see the power of God at work. Look what God has done. And so let's do that today as we dive into Acts chapter 13. Now, what you'll find is in Acts chapter 13, the background of this text is Saul and Barnabas became a team when Barnabas reached out to Saul and brought him to Antioch in Syria. Antioch in Syria, there was a great revival that had broken out, and when the church in Jerusalem heard about this great revival, they sent Barnabas to check it out because Barnabas was a son of encouragement. Barnabas was a man full of the Holy Spirit. Barnabas was a man who knew how to assess things and nurture it along. He was one of those people that if you look at his pattern throughout the New Testament, he was always finding something or someone that was kind of an underdog, not really, but he saw the seeds of God's work in that person, and he would nurture it into growth. And so he had done this with Saul, and Saul came and worked with him in Antioch in Syria. And then there were some prophets that came up from Jerusalem, and they told about a famine that was going to be coming. And so the people in Antioch put together a collection and sent it at the hands of Saul and Barnabas and a few others to Jerusalem. And we begin chapter 13 where Saul and Barnabas had come back from Jerusalem. They came to Antioch in Syria, and they brought a young man with them, John Mark. And this man became their assistant. And at the beginning of chapter 13, we're not going to read it, but they were set apart by the Holy Spirit for a work that he had called them to do, and that was evangelism, and that was going out on this apostolic work of setting up churches and preaching the gospel in places where it hadn't been preached. And they took John Mark with them. Well, they had preached with some fair success in a number of places, but they also ran into difficulty, and I'm not sure exactly what it was, but immediately before the message that we're going to look at today, John Mark decided it was too tough, and he headed back to Jerusalem and left Saul and Barnabas on their own. Also, in this chapter 13, in verse 9 of chapter 13, we read, I believe, the first time that Saul was also called Paul. And from there on in the book of Acts, Saul is known as Paul. Kind of just a bit of trivia for you. But anyway, some people say, well, who is Saul? Who is Paul? Well, in verse 9 of chapter 13 of Acts, he had a name change, at least what they all began to call him. So at that point, he became Paul. So Paul and Barnabas made a practice of preaching the gospel in Jewish synagogues as a starting point. They'd go to a new city, enter the synagogue, and if given an opportunity, would speak and share with the Jews first. That was a practice that I sometimes wondered, why didn't they just head out for the Gentiles right away? But Paul speaks about that, to the Jew first and also to the Gentile. And praise God, the also to the Gentile works because that's you and I. And I bless God for that. What a great salvation God has given to us. And we should be forever grateful for his grafting us into that tree of promise. So John left them, but let's begin reading at Acts 13, verse 13. Now when Paul and his party set sail from Paphos, they came to Perga in Pamphylia, and John, departing from them, returned to Jerusalem. But when they departed from Perga, they came to Antioch in Pisidia and went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and sat down. And after the reading of the law and the prophets, the rulers of the synagogue sent to them, saying, Men and brethren, if you have any word of exhortation for the people, say on. So you see the setting. They're in this new Antioch, Antioch and Pisidia, and they are ready to meet the Jews. And they go into the synagogue on the Sabbath. And I love the context of this. They just sit down to listen to the reading of the Word of God. They're not asking to preach. They're not doing any of that. They just sit down. And after the reading of the law and the prophets, after they have heard the Word of God, and it doesn't tell us what the selection was they read that day, but after the reading, the leaders of the synagogue somehow, I don't know, they passed a note, sent somebody over to talk to them, but somehow got a message to them and said, listen, if you have any word of exhortation, or many translations say of encouragement for the people, say it. And boy, does Paul bring a word of exhortation. Look what God has done. And if there's ever a day that we need that word of exhortation, it's now. If I look around today and I hear people talking about the discouragement that we have and wondering what in the world is going to happen in our world, and you have this thing hanging over our heads that evil men and seducers are going to wax worse and worse, and there's going to be a time of falling away and all of these things, and can there be any redemption for us in this place? Well, Paul starts out and says, I just want to tell you what God has done. And friends, look at what God has done. He says, God chose our fathers. Boy, that's encouraging. God chose them. And what does he mean by that? Well, this morning at numerous times in the service, I noticed at least three or four times, whether it was in the singing or in the speaking, there was mention made of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. These are the fathers that are spoken of. And Paul says, God chose our fathers. God chose our fathers. Abraham, if you would look in Genesis 12, 1 to 3, you're going to see that God chose Abraham. You say, well, yeah, but Abraham had to respond. Yes, he did. But guess who made the invitation? God did. And God says this, now the Lord said to Abram, get out of your country, from your family, and from your father's house to a land I will show you. I will make you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great, and you shall be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse him who curses you, and in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. And then later on in Genesis 15:6, we read that Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him for righteousness. But God chose him. God called him. God presented this before him, and Abraham believed the word of God, and the Bible says that God justified him on the basis of his faith. And what an amazing thing. So when Paul stands up and he says, brothers and devout believers in God, God chose our fathers. He's bringing to mind this great moment when God says, I'm going to bless you. I'm going to make you a great nation. I am going to bless those who bless you, and I'm going to curse those who curse you, and in you all nations of the world will be blessed. Can you imagine what a word of exhortation that is, sitting in the synagogue that morning under the thumb of the rule of Rome? God chose us. It's a beautiful word of exhortation, but he doesn't stop there. If you think of Isaac, God also chose Isaac. Abraham had many sons by the time he died. And before he had Isaac, he had Ishmael. And in Genesis 21, 8 to 13, specifically 21, 12, we read this, but God said to Abraham, do not let it be displeasing in your sight because of the lad, that's Ishmael, or because of your bondwoman, that's Hagar. Whatever Sarah has said to you, listen to her voice. For, notice the choice, in Isaac, your seed will be called. God chose Isaac. And then he chose Jacob and his family. Genesis 25, 21 to 26, and 28, 13 to 16, and Exodus 1, 1 to 5, we see that God didn't just choose one of Jacob's sons. I mean, of Isaac. God chose one of Isaac's sons, and then he chose that son's family. But Jacob, listen to this. God chose Jacob. Genesis 28, 13 to 16. And behold, the Lord stood above it and said, I am the Lord God of Abraham, your father, and the God of Isaac. The land on which you lie, I will give to you and your descendants. Also, your descendants shall be as the dust of the earth. You shall spread abroad to the west and the east, to the north and the south, and in you and your seed all the families of the earth shall be blessed. Behold, I am with you, and will keep you wherever you go, and I will bring you back to this land, for I will not leave you until I have done what I have spoken to you. Then Jacob, that's the one he's talking to, awoke from his sleep and said, surely the Lord is in this place, and I did not know it. See, God spoke this to Jacob. I don't know if Jacob was in the mood of prayer or not, but God met him and spoke to him and says, I'm not going to depart from you until I do what I have told you. Now, we know Jacob's life wasn't that easy. He was a deceiver. He had sown a lot of wild oats. And some of the things God took him through to bring him back in a place where he could use him took a little time and took a little effort and took a few shenanigans of others played on him, but he learned his lessons. Got to the place where on returning to the land of Israel, he wrestled with the Lord all night, with an angel of the Lord. Look what God has done. I want you to get that. Look what God has done. Because so often we become discouraged and we wonder where all of this is going because it feels like whatever he was doing, he stopped doing, and it just feels like it's out here in la-la land, and we're wondering what comes next. In those moments, the word of exhortation is, look what God has done. Look what God... A while back, there was this idea and this little thing that went around, and we had bracelets and we had everything else, and that was, what would Jesus do? Well, I think the bigger thing is, look what God has done. Remember what he has done. Don't forget. We sang this morning, we remember the miracles you've done. We remember the victories you've won. Sometimes that is a choice. And Paul, as he stands up to encourage and give a word of exhortation, says, brothers, God chose our fathers. And he goes on and he says, God exalted the people and they dwelt when they dwelt as strangers in Egypt. Well, Exodus 1, verse 7 says this. But the children of Israel were fruitful and increased abundantly, multiplied and grew exceedingly mighty, and the land was filled with them. Now, I don't know about you, but when I read a verse like that, I'm saying, yeah, they were exalted. Something was going on. They were fruitful and they increased abundantly. They multiplied and grew exceedingly. How many of you think that's probably a lot of people that happened to be there? Well, they didn't just happen to be there. God was doing it. He was exalting them in size, in stature. In fact, it got so bad that the king of Egypt looked and said, these guys are bigger and stronger than us. Unless we take some action quickly, they're going to ruin our culture. They're going to take over. Or they might even leave us, and then what are we going to do? Our economy would be devastated. Today, we're bringing people in to try to do something. I'm not sure, but I have a feeling our economy will be devastated by our policies. But that's for maybe brains bigger than mine. But you see what was going on. And he said, this is incredible. God exalted them. Where? Well, they were strangers in Egypt. They became slaves, but God exalted them. Remember what God has done. This was a tumultuous time for their lives. And then we read on. He chose our fathers, exalted the people when they dwelt as strangers in the land of Egypt, and with an uplifted arm, that means in a mighty way, he brought them out of Egypt. Now, when you think about that, Matt reminded us this morning of the season that we're in of Passover and the Exodus, and that was where it started. God says, I'm going to bring you out of Egypt. And he calls Moses. And of course, you know the story. Moses goes back to Egypt. And everybody was like, great, we're going to be, God's noticed us, we're going to be getting out of slavery. And then immediately their work got harder. They didn't get straw to make bricks. They were beaten, and they said, well, we're in a bad way. And then they got angry at Moses. And God says, no, I'm going to bring you out. And so, of course, you know the story of the 10 plagues. And the last plague was the death angel coming through Egypt. The death angel coming and killing the firstborn. But there was the Passover, in which God allowed, and he warned them, and he said, take a lamb without blemish and kill it and put its blood over the doorpost. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you. And in Egypt, on that night of the Passover, when the death angel came through, there was a death in every house. On some, it was the death of the firstborn. On others, it was the death of a lamb as a substitute. But there was death in every house. It's a little bit like that passage of Scripture that says, some men's sins go before to judgment and some follow after. For those who were willing to acknowledge the righteousness of God, they killed the lamb, put the blood on the doorpost, and the firstborn was spared. But it was this very event, the Passover, that propelled Israel out of Egypt. The Egyptians were willing to hurry them out of town, out of country, so to speak. But then they came to the Red Sea, and it looked like they were trapped in, and yet God made a way. So as Paul is bringing this word of encouragement, he is reminding the people in the synagogue of what God has done. And I'm wondering, in your own life this morning, do you remember the great things God has done for you? As a word of encouragement, what are the great things He has done? These are things He did for Israel. These are things that were laying the foundation for our salvation in Christ. These were things that were preparing the way. And he continues on, and he says, now for a time of about, verse 18, for a time of about 40 years, he put up with their ways in the wilderness. Now he's not reminding them of all of the crazy things that Israel had done. But we can read about these about 40 years in Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. That's a lot of time and attention given to 40 years that he put up with them. How many years has he put up with you, with me, with us? How many chances has he brought around for us? We like to say God is a God of second chances. I'll say I think God is a God of millions of opportunities. How many sins have you committed? The average person says, well, probably at least a million. Well, how many times does God forgive? He says, if we confess our sins, He's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So here they were in the wilderness, and God put up with them. There's so much that could be said here about Israel, but the message that Paul is preaching is focused on what God has done to bring salvation for the people. He's intent on this, and the only real hint we get is when he says he put up with them. These were cantankerous people. They were stiff-necked. They were stubborn. They were rebellious, much like a lot of us have been, and maybe still are. I don't know. It's fun to read Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy and point fingers at Israel until I realize that I look awful much like them. Then it's not so much fun anymore. Then I like to think about how rigorous the law was. And maybe that's why they acted that way, and maybe that's why I act the way I do. No, the issue is sin in my heart, and I needed salvation from that. And that is what he's telling them. Listen, friends, God has done it. Then he goes on to say in verse 19, and he destroyed seven nations in the land of Canaan. God did that. You say, well, I thought Israel went in and conquered that. Trust me. God went before them. God brought the victory. God destroyed those nations before Israel and gave them the land by inheritance, by allotment. And friends, God has placed his name and his stamp and his ownership on that piece of property. He has made a covenant with the land, and he's made a covenant with the people. And today, that still is the land of Israel, the land of God. And God says that is where he will plant the feet of Messiah at the second coming. When he comes again, he will stand in Israel, in Jerusalem, on the Mount of Olives. This is a very important place. And Paul reminds them, look what God has done. He brought them in. He destroyed those seven nations, and he gave their land to Israel, and Israel inhabited it. And then at the end of that verse, and sometimes at the beginning in our New King James rendering here, it says in verse 20, after that he gave them judges for about 450 years until Samuel the prophet. Now, just about every other translation, including the American Standard, says it this way at the end of saying where he destroyed seven nations in the land of Canaan, distributed their land by allotment. It said this all took about 450 years. And then it starts in verse 20 and says, and he gave them judges until the time of Samuel. So the rendering there, you may kind of look at that, but whatever the case, 450 years. Friends, God plays the long game. 450 years. We are 248 years in July from the signing of the Declaration of Independence. 248. That means we're still in Egypt if we're Israel. What has God done? God plays the long game in these things. And there are things that we say, where is God in all of this? 450 years to bring him to the time of the judges. And God's plan is not over. God's plan is still working. I hear people say sometimes, well, how much longer do I have to deal with this? I don't know if I can handle it anymore. Listen, God plays the long game, and the promises that he has given to us are sure. That situation that you're facing right now, God doesn't forget. God doesn't forget. God is a God who plays, and I don't even like to use the word play, but I hope you understand what I mean. God continues. And his purposes and his plans, even when they're stated years and years in advance, continue on. There are things that there are people today that say, I just can't wait anymore. I've given up. I've given up on God. Don't do it. Paul gives us word of exhortation, and he says, all this beginning stuff took 450 years. But that's nothing to the plan that he was unfolding to expose, to reveal Messiah. So these judges, after this, God gave Israel judges until the time of Samuel the prophet. If you've ever read the books of Judges and Ruth, and even 1 Samuel, you're going to remember that these days were tumultuous days. They were chaotic. If you read some of the stories in the book of Judges, especially at the end, it's disturbing. It's unsettling to think that these kinds of things were happening to people that God had called out. You wonder, can anything good come out of this situation? The book of Judges is one failure after another, punctuated by this deliverer that comes in. And yet God was not finished. God's plans continue on. Paul says, I want to give you encouragement. Look what God has done. God gave them judges. God gave them Samuel. And then when Samuel was about done, they were tired of judges. And they said, I think the judges are the problem. We'd get along quite well if we just had a king. And so they asked for a king, and God gave them Saul. And 40 years later, he took him away. Why? Because Saul was not a good king. Saul was something that they were looking for, but wasn't what God wanted to give. And so God gave them 40 years. It's interesting. He had them wander in the wilderness for 40 years. He gives them Saul 40 years. And then he brings David, a man after his own heart. He raises him up. Paul says, look what God did. He gave them Saul. He took Saul away and he raised up David. And he blessed David. We can read about David and Saul in 1 and 2 Samuel. God raised up David. And this is what he says in verse 22. After he had removed him, that is Saul, he raised up for them David as king, to whom he also gave testimony and said, I have found David, the son of Jesse, a man after my own heart who will do all my will. And then verse 23, from this man's seed, according to the promise, God raised up for Israel a Savior, Jesus. Look what God has done. This is a long time after David, by the way. But God was able to preserve that lineage right on down through and bring Messiah and reveal him to the world, a Savior. Matt talked today about the thing of walking into the temple. And it wasn't a nice thing where, I mean, I don't know how many of you have wrestled a sheep or led a sheep in a suit and tie, but I'm going to guess that was not the most clean worship service in a sense. I mean, it had to be pure and it had to be kosher, it had to be all of that. But it was humiliating. As you laid your hands on the head of that sheep or that animal, whatever it was, and confessed your sins. Something had to die of your own identity because, you know, we like to pray those little prayers when we confess our sins in quiet. But what would it be like if to find atonement you walked into the sanctuary in the midst of all of this and in front of the preachers or the priests, put your hands on this thing and says, I've done this and I've done this. And you'd want to be thorough because this blood is the substitute. I don't want to go home unclean. I don't want to go home with guilt. I want to lay all my guilt on the Lamb. And then comes Jesus. Jesus. But he takes this little break and he pops over to the witness that John gave about him. After John, verse 24, after John had first preached before his coming the baptism of repentance to all the people of Israel, as John was finishing his course, he said, who do you think I am? I'm not he, but behold, there comes one after me, the sandals of whose feet I am not worthy to loose. Men and brethren, Paul continues, sons of the family of Abraham, and those among you who fear God, To you, this word of salvation is preached. This, remember, is a word of encouragement. Coming to the people in the synagogue who had just listened to the law, the reading of the law and the prophets. They're living under the authority of Rome. And a word of encouragement comes and says, to you, this word of salvation is being preached. To you. And then he goes on, and I'm going to read this and come back and just talk about it a little bit. For those who dwell in Jerusalem and their rulers, because they did not know him, that is Jesus, nor even the voices, or they didn't recognize the voices of the prophets, which are read every Sabbath, have fulfilled them in condemning him. And though they found no cause for death in him, they asked Pilate that he should be put to death. Now, when they had fulfilled all that was written concerning him, they took him down from the tree and laid him in a tomb. But God raised him from the dead. God raised him from the dead. And he was seen for many days by those who came up with him from Galilee to Jerusalem, who are his witnesses to the people. And we declare to you glad tidings. That promise which was made to the Father, God has fulfilled, to the fathers, God has fulfilled this for us, their children, in that he has raised up Jesus. This resurrection is important. It's powerful. He says that, first of all, God had raised him up, but the people, the nation of Israel, didn't recognize Jesus. There were some who did, but there were the rulers didn't. And they didn't want to recognize Jesus because they were jealous of Jesus and his authority and his power and the things he taught. And they willfully turned their back on him. They willfully looked for a reason to destroy him. And here we get the message of the gospel that is typically preached is this. Jesus Christ, who went about doing good, accused falsely, condemned unjustly, hung on a cross, taken down from the cross, put into a tomb for 3 days, and resurrected by God. But can I tell you, the one who did all of this is God. Is God. Look what God has done. And friends, if God has done that, is there a reason to fear today that he won't fulfill his promises? If it was 450 years to the judges, and then you look at the 1,000 or so years of Israel's history where they were exiled, they were brought back, and they were conquered, and their idolatry and all of that. And you say, how in the world does God do that? How does he stay with the course? How does he stay with his promises? How does he do all of this when people are so bent on doing what he doesn't want them to do? He says, even here, he took and the leaders of Israel and the people gathered together and did what God had already said was going to happen. And through their ignorance, through their rebellion, through their sin, God redeems humanity by raising Christ. Now, was it a good thing for them to do that? Well, I wouldn't want that to be on my charge, but guess what? It is. Because God has laid on him the iniquities of us all. In Zechariah, we read that they're going to look on him whom they pierced and they're going to mourn. Who's going to mourn? Well, it's talking about the nation of Israel, but it's also, friends, all of us who come face to face with Christ and his salvation for our sins should be mourning when we see him whom we, our sins, have pierced. Yeah, there was a generation in Jerusalem that put him on a cross. But guess why? Because he was dying for the sins of the world, for your sins, for my sins. And if I look at him and I don't have any trace of emotion, when I see what that my sins pierced him, there's a problem. I need to be turning from those sins. I need to be walking in repentance. And today in our churches, we're not doing much of that. You see, today in our churches, we want the power of the resurrection, but we don't want the presence of the resurrected one. There's a lot of people wanting the power of the Holy Spirit, but they really aren't that interested in the person of the Holy Spirit. There are a lot of people today who want power, but don't want the relationship. In fact, I was reading one good old dead guy now, but he wrote and he said, we have this issue with deicide. We want to kill God. If we could, we'd want his power and leave him out of the story. And there's far too many people today in our churches and in our world who want the power of God, but not the presence of God. And friends, you're not going to have the power of God without his presence. This is something that is so important. And as Paul is preaching this message of encouragement, he is telling them, listen, this salvation is to us. And what is he saying in that? Essentially, that your sins put him on the cross. That's why you need salvation. That's why I need salvation. This message is for us. It's a word of encouragement. Look what God has done. But if you're thinking that your life is not necessary, you don't need a lot of saving, you just need more power. Friends, I've got news for you. You need complete transformation. You need complete You need a complete change of your spiritual DNA so that it only is the Son living through you. That the life you now live is through the life of Christ. He continues on and talks about the importance of the resurrection of the Messiah. Look what God has done. God raised him. As it is also written in the second psalm. And I want to just flip over to Psalm 2, because this is the second psalm he refers to. It says, "You are my son, today I have begotten you." But I want to read you what Paul was reminded of. He makes one quote out of Psalm 2, but when he says this, it should have reminded everyone in the synagogue of Psalm 2, because this was a very common psalm for them to read. And this is what it says, beginning at verse 1, "Why do the nations rage, and the people plot a vain thing?" Why do the nations rage? Why do they rage today? Why are they plotting these things? He says, "The kings of the earth set themselves, and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed, saying, 'Let us break their bonds in pieces and cast their cords away from us.' He who sits in heaven shall laugh. The Lord shall hold them in derision. Then he shall speak to them in his wrath and distress them in his deep displeasure. Yet I have set my king on my holy hill of Zion." Friends, it is a terrible thing to plot against God and his plans. And today the nations of the world are plotting against God's plans for his kingdom in Israel. This is what he says in verse 7, "I will declare the decree. The Lord has said to me, 'You are my son, and today I have begotten you.'" That's what Paul quoted. "Ask of me, and I will give you the nations for your inheritance, and the ends of the earth for your possession. You shall break them with a rod of iron, and shall dash them to pieces like a potter's vessel." Some of these things are yet to occur. We read about them in Revelation, where this is what the one who has the seven stars and stands in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. This is the one who will break who will rule the nations with a rod of iron. This is what God has done. "Now therefore, be wise, O kings," verse 10, "be instructed, you judges of the earth." And I speak this today as a warning to the nations of our current day. "Therefore, be wise, O king. Be instructed, you judges of the earth. Serve the Lord with fear and rejoice with trembling. Kiss the Son, lest he be angry, and you perish in the way when his wrath is kindled but a little. Blessed are those that put their trust in him." To the nations of the world today, this should be a warning. This should be a warning. Serve the Lord with fear. Kiss the Son, lest he be angry with thee. But today there are a lot of nations that are not doing that. They are kicking at the offspring, at the chosen people. They are kicking at these things in the world because the world is opposed to God. Well, he continues on as he talks about the power and the glory of the resurrection. God's promise, he says, has been fulfilled in the resurrection. "And that he raised him," verse 34 of Acts 13, "and that he raised him from the dead, no more to return to corruption, he has spoken thus." And we find that in Isaiah 55, "I will give you the sure mercies of David." Therefore, he also says in another psalm, "You will not allow your Holy One to see corruption," and that's Psalm 16:10. I'm going to read a couple of verses out of there because it's important. Psalm 16, verses 8 to 11. "I have set the Lord always before me, because he is at my right hand. I shall not be moved. Therefore, my heart is glad and my glory rejoices. My flesh also will rest in hope. For you will not leave my soul in Sheol, nor will you allow your Holy One to see corruption. You will show me the path of life. In your presence is fullness of joy, and in your right hand are pleasures forevermore." Friends, is your heart glad this morning? Are you walking in the light of what God has done? Do you know what he has done? And in his presence is fullness of joy. You know, there's a lot of us that say, well, I'm not full of joy. Well, then the problem may be that you're not aware where you are. Are you in the presence of God? Doesn't mean you're going to be always happy, 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 but it does mean that there is a fullness of joy, a calm assurance, a joyful satisfaction of knowing that He has me and that my needs are met, that my future is assured, that I don't have to worry. And if you're not, and if you are not in His presence and you're not experiencing fullness of joy, then you need to know where you are as well so that you can get to His presence. Fullness of joy. The resurrection assures us of very good news. Verses 38 and 39. That good news is this. That through this man is preached to you the forgiveness of sins. And by him, everyone who believes is justified from all things from which you could not be justified by the law of Moses. The resurrection assures us of those two things. First of all, through Jesus is preached the forgiveness of sins, and by Jesus is justification. Through Jesus is forgiveness of sins. Are your sins forgiven? You know, there was a lady that came and poured oil on Jesus. She wept on his feet and wiped them with her hair and poured oil on him. And Jesus asked Simon, his host, he gave him a little parable, and he talked about two men who owed their master some money. One a lot, the other very little. The master forgave them both. And he said, which one of these will love his master the most? And Simon says, well, I suppose the one he forgave the most. And Jesus says, you've answered correctly. This woman, whose sins are many, has been forgiven because she loved much. And Jesus tells her, her sins are forgiven. Why? Some people say, well, who is he that can forgive sins? Jesus says, here is the deal. The proof is this. Her sins are forgiven because she loved much. She loved much. Friends, are your sins forgiven? Or are you cranky, critical? How much do you love? It doesn't do a lot of good, according to Jesus, to say, yep, I was forgiven of my sins, and to be out there recounting all the sins of everybody else. Because the one who is forgiven is going to have a change of heart, a change of walk. And there are some people today who claim to be forgiven, who claim to have the Spirit of God at work in them, and are some of the most critical, judgmental, hard-talking people that you can meet. How does that work? Not very well, according to Jesus. Through this Jesus is preached the forgiveness of sins, and by Jesus is justification from all of the things you could never work to accomplish. You could never work off. There's so many of us that want to get our lives cleaned up before we come to Christ. We want to impress Him. And Jesus came because we couldn't impress Him. Jesus was necessary. The death of Christ on the cross was absolutely necessary because there is no way that we could be in the presence of God and experience the fullness of joy without Him. And it's by Him that justification is given. Romans chapter 8, who's going to bring a charge against us? It's God that justifies. You see, look what God has done. Look what God has done. And then he ends this in this amazing sermon. I love the way Paul doesn't accuse anyone in this message except telling them that they need salvation. You need to be saved. And now he gets to the end and he's saying, you can be justified for the things that you could never work off before. All of the things that you did trying to work off your sin, it didn't work. And so he gives them this very gracious, soft way of saying, you need salvation. And if I need salvation, then I'm a sinner. And I'm in desperate need of God's grace and God's mercy. But then he gives a warning against unbelief, and it's a warning that he quotes out of Habakkuk 1:5. And it just says this, beware, verse 40, beware therefore lest what has been spoken in the prophets come upon you. And this is what he quotes, behold, you despisers. Despisers? These are people who fear God, people who are in the synagogue listening to the word of God. Marvel and perish, for I work a work in your days, a work which you will by no means believe, though one were to declare it to you. Well, Paul says, I just declared it to you, right? So what's the response to this message? That was the message. What's the response to the message? Well, when the Jews went out of the synagogue, the Gentiles begged that these words might be preached to them the next Sabbath. So the Gentiles were really excited about this. They were interested in hearing more. And when the congregation had broken up, verse 43, many of the Jews and devout proselytes followed Paul and Barnabas, who, speaking to them, persuaded them to continue in the grace of God. So far, so good. But then came the next Sabbath. And sometimes there's a great response to a message. Oh, good message, preacher, good word. Thank you for that message. Yeah, what touched you in it? Well, I'm not sure, all of it, I think. Well, actually, I slept through part of it. No, it's sometimes you don't find out the effect of the message until the next week. And the next week, the whole town shows up to listen to the message, or almost the whole town. But, verse 45, when the Jews saw the multitudes, they were filled with envy. And contradicting and blaspheming, they opposed the things spoken by Paul. Brothers and sisters, I want to tell you something that is very crucial. We see it in these Jews, and we see it today in the church. We see it on YouTube, exposés of false teachers. By my own authority, they're a false one. And by my authority, they're a false one. But we see this jealousy, and jealousy and envy do terrible things. If you want to quench the work of the Spirit of God in your life, nurture a heart of envy and jealousy toward others. Now, why would you want to quench the Spirit of God in your life? I don't know. But how many of you nurture? How many of us? How many times do I deal with a spirit of envy and jealousy? And can I tell you that all of this that with such good news the week before is today vigorously opposed by the Jews who know the story better than anybody else, but they don't like the crowds that came to these strangers. And Paul and Barnabas, responding to this, this is crazy. They were filled with envy, and they contradicting and blaspheming, they opposed the things spoken by Paul. Things they knew were true. Because of envy, they turned around and fought against it. Things they knew were in the Scriptures. Things they knew God had done. They're standing up and saying it's not true. Envy, jealousy. And Paul and Barnabas grew bold and said, it was necessary that the word of God should be spoken to you first. But since you reject it and judge yourselves unworthy of everlasting life, behold, we turn to the Gentiles. For so the Lord has commanded us. I have set you as a light to the Gentiles, that you should be for salvation to the ends of the earth. I want to just flip over and read this because it's out of Isaiah 49. Isaiah 49, is a powerful passage. And I want to read verses 5 through 9. And now the Lord says, who formed me from the womb to be his servant, speaking of Messiah, to bring Jacob back to him so that Israel is gathered to him. For I shall be glorious in the eyes of the Lord, and my God shall be my strength. Indeed, he says, it is too small a thing that you should be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob and to restore the preserved ones of Israel. I will also give you as a light to the Gentiles, that you should be my salvation to the ends of the earth. Thus says the Lord, the Redeemer of Israel, their Holy One, to him whom man despises, to him whom the nation abhors, to the servant of rulers, kings shall see and arise, princes shall also worship, because of the Lord who is faithful, the Holy One of Israel, and he has chosen you. Thus says the Lord, in an acceptable time I have heard you. In the day of salvation I have helped you. I will preserve you and give you as a covenant to the people, to restore the earth, to cause them to inherit the desolate heritages, that you may say to the prisoners, go forth, and to those who are in darkness, show yourselves. And they shall feed along the roads, and their pastures shall be on all the desolate heights. These scriptures that Paul brings into the message, and when he rebukes the Jews for their envy, and he says, I've set you as a light to the Gentiles, he wants them to remember not only that this is what God has prophesied, but what was prophesied about Messiah. It's another message of grace and mercy to these people who are opposing him. He's saying, remember the words of Isaiah. Remember that he is going to make Messiah, the one who will call people out of darkness and tell them, be seen. He's going to call these that are in prison. He's going to have them come forth. Friends, that is good news. And the good news is this, that God is doing that through Jesus, is calling you to step out. Calling you to step out of your insecurities, your inferiorities, your failures and all of these things and come for salvation to be seen, that the light might shine on you and that you will not be bound up any longer. This is the message that he's given them. And the Gentiles who heard this were glad and glorified the Lord. And as many as had been appointed to eternal life believed. The word of God was being spread throughout all that region as they believed and shared it. But the Jews stirred up a persecution against Paul and Barnabas. They stirred up the devout and prominent women and the chief men of the city, raised up a persecution against Paul and Barnabas, and expelled them from their region. And they, that is the disciples, shook off the dust from their feet against them and came to Iconium, and the disciples were filled with joy and the Holy Spirit. If the worship team wants to come forward, and I'll be done here in just a few minutes. How do we get to this point? Well, a little while ago I had read that, and Paul says, I've given you the sure mercies of David. That's out of Isaiah 55, verse 3. And I want to read Isaiah 55, 3 to 7. Because where do we get to the point of persecuting through envy? Where do we get to the point of believing? Where do we get to the point, and how do we get to the point of the disciples who remained, even with all the chaos that had ensued right there in that area? The preachers had been expelled, but those who believed were filled with joy and with the Holy Spirit. It's through this. Isaiah 55, verse 3. Incline your ear and come to me. Hear, and your soul shall live. And I will make an everlasting covenant with you, the sure mercies of David. Indeed, I have given him as a witness to the people, a leader and a commander for the people. Surely you shall call a nation you do not know, and nations who do not know you shall run to you because of the Lord your God and the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified you. Seek the Lord. Here's where we come in. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, and he will have mercy on him and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. Friends, when we are so prone to bitterness and jealousy, we will never be able to enter into the fullness of what he is saying, seeking the Lord while he may be found. We can't do that because we're so bound up and we're so jealous, we're so envious of what other people are doing. And this morning, I feel like God has really laid it on my heart to ask you, what is it that is keeping you in the dark this morning? What is it that is keeping you in opposition to what God has stated and what God has given and what he has done in salvation? What is it that you are hanging on to that you can't let go and you can't receive this? Because God has done it. And if we're not living in it, it's probably because we're still wanting his power and not his person. What's keeping you in the dark? What's keeping you in a place where you're not willing to step out and just embrace what God has done? The Jews opposed it because they were envious. Why do you oppose it? Why do you disregard it? Why do you say in your soul, it's not for me, it's not true, God's forgotten me? Why do you say that? You say, well, John, my life is so tough, I can't do anything about it. No, you can, because he has done it. That's the word of exhortation. He has done it. Why? Why this morning will you not answer that? What is it that is holding you in a place of bondage? He's done it. He's done it. Look what he's done. It's through Christ that forgiveness for anything that we have done is possible. It's through Christ that our justification is available. Why? Why won't you come? I'm not asking you to come up here this morning, though you may. I'm just asking you why you're not coming to him. Why is it that you are standing against these things and saying, I'm not sure I even believe God anymore. He sure hasn't come through for me. He's not coming through for my family. He's not coming through for all of these things. Listen, God has done it. God has done it. Look what he's done. Look at the things he's done in your life in the past. Don't look at somebody else and you say, he gets all the breaks. God does everything good in his life. He just doesn't like me. That's not true. Friends, if you're looking just for power and not for the person of God, there's a problem. God will not give anyone his power without his person. And if you're rejecting his person because of envy or bitterness or anger or any of those other things, you're not going to have his power at work in your life. You might have power of some sort, but it's not going to be his, because his is holy. His is true, and his comes on the basis of his love and his forgiveness and his mercy. And those characteristics must be in our lives if we are going to operate in the power of God. What's holding you back? What stands in the way? Is it a crowd of city people coming out to embrace a message? Is it that somebody is more popular than you? Is it that somebody seems to get the breaks and you don't? Is it just the fact that you said, I've been living in the time of judges and everybody does what's right in their eyes and they're all hurting me? Guess what? Even through the time of the judges, God worked his purpose and his plan. Through those 450 years of wandering, God kept his purpose and his plan. God has done it. What is holding you back this morning? I pray to God that you answer that question honestly in your hearts, because look what he has done. The message is for you. It's the message is for me. The message is for all of us. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way. Let every one of us forsake what stands in the way of grasping what God has done. And let's walk in repentance before him. Worship team, God bless.
Just remain standing. Thank you, Pastor John, for the word you delivered to us this morning. And there's one verse that kept coming back to me as he was sharing. In Hebrews, it says, "How shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation?" And it goes on to say that it was first spoken to us by the Lord, and then it was confirmed to us by those who heard him. So it's been confirmed over and over and over again. The complete and the finality of the work of the cross is complete and done, and it's been confirmed, it's been spoken of over and over and over. And probably the only reason it doesn't work for us is because of us, our own things, our own selfish desires, our own flesh. And, you know, as John mentioned, this sermon that Paul preached here, if you look at all the sermons that have been preached, especially in the New Testament, it seems like they go back and they begin in the Old Testament. They begin to lay a foundation. Paul did it. Peter did it. Stephen did it. Jesus did it. They all went back and they made a reference point of where we came from and where we currently are. And if you look at where you were and where you now are, if you draw a line, that line tends to point out the trajectory that you currently are on. You know, none of us are exactly where we should be or could be, but there's a trajectory that you've placed yourself on. And in fact, Paul even makes mention then in Ephesians of where we were. And I always think sometimes when life gets chaotic and it gets busy and it gets overwhelming, there's one thing that always sets everything back in place. There's always one thing you can go to, and there's one thing for sure. I was completely dead in my trespasses and sins. I was hopeless. I had no hope. I was dead. You know, I wasn't even bad or I wasn't even evil. I was dead. You know, when you have a viewing and there's a dead body, that person may have been good or he may have been bad, but currently they're neither one of those. They're just dead. You really can't have a conversation with a dead person. A dead person has no rights. There's no hope for a dead person apart from a miraculous resurrection. And so Paul says that's where we once were. And so, however, he said, according to his riches, but God, who is rich in mercy, and because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, in our sins. And this is what salvation has done. is it's made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. He raised us up together, made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. Paul says here that God is rich. And guess what he's going to do with that riches? In the ages to come, he's going to flaunt his riches of his grace towards us. And it's going to be such a great flaunt because of where we once were. We were dead. And it's his grace and his riches that he's going to flaunt towards us in the age to come. So let's not forget the price that was paid and what we have ahead of us because of his great mercy, his riches and his mercy. So thank you again, Pastor John, for bringing us a powerful word. Search your heart. What's blocking you? What kind of perhaps envy or jealousy or bitterness? What kind of root of bitterness is there that perhaps is blocking you from this great riches here? We're seated in heavenly places with Christ right now because of his salvation. So thank you. Bless you, and I pray that you have a wonderful week as you seek the Lord. So let's pray, and then we'll be dismissed. Father, we thank you for your word this morning. We bless you for it. We thank you, God, that you have been so faithful. And Lord, I just pray that you would just put an urgency in all of our hearts to never neglect, to never forget the great salvation that you have done, that you have put in place, that you have completed. It is total. It is final. We cannot add to it. We cannot take away from it. But God, in your infinite wisdom, you have placed before us such great hope and resurrection power. I just pray, God, that this week you would visit the dead places of our lives, the places that perhaps we have just given up all hope in, because God, your salvation has made a way for those things to become alive. And so, Lord, I just pray for a blessing on each one that is here, each person that is here that represents you. Lord, you have given us a place on this earth to occupy until you come. And Lord, we can rest in the occupation that you have given us because of the great salvation that you've blessed us with. We thank you, we bless you, and praise you. And in Jesus' name we pray, amen. And you're dismissed.